WhatsApp CAs is now something like 59 or 60. I'm sure there are many other chartered accountants who will join. So 60 is not a bad number. It's a good beginning, I must say. And also thank Gautam Ma'am for inviting me to this session today to talk about new challenges facing the chartered accountants or new opportunities which are there for the chartered accountants. So I have, as I mentioned in my introduction, I spent my entire career, as I said, I passed in 1981, so almost close to 40 years. I have been working in industry, but worked with practicing chartered accountants who were on the other side for all these 41 years. So I can try to talk on behalf of both CAs working in the industry as well as those who are working in practice. And based on the introduction given, I find that our Bhanap community chartered accountants have got very well diversified kind of a portfolio of experience, starting from industry, manufacturing industry, then financial services, then audit firms, and some of you also have your own practice. So let me start by saying that I'll start by first talking about this impact of COVID on the global economy. I'll be very brief on that, and then I will come to the Indian economy and impact, what changes it would mean as far as Indian economy is concerned arising out of this COVID effect, and then what are the challenges and the opportunities available to the chartered accountants in India. So that would be my attempt to cover this topic. So first of all, let me try to start by saying that 2019, the year which got over three months ago, was itself showing the signs of recession and economic slowdown across the globe, except maybe US economy. India also, we had started seeing the slowdown. And now to add to that, we have this the pandemic of COVID. Nobody really knows when it would end and to what extent the slowdown will impact most of the economies. And it has already reached about 150 countries. So it's not just a few countries. It's started from China, but it's now covering almost 150 countries. So the impact is going to be across the globe. And there are various estimates in terms of how this particular pandemic will impact various countries. But one overall consensus is that the impact will be worse than perhaps even the Great Depression, which happened in early 1930s in the US, and it had its effect across the globe. So in the US itself, the unemployment rate that time was about 25%. And already US has now shown unemployment rate close to 8%. Till end of December, the unemployment rate was at the historical lowest level of 2% or 2.5% in the US. It's already gone to about between 6.5% to 8%. In India, as per the data released by the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, that CMIE, the unemployment rate has already reached 23.5%. So India is also going to be badly impacted, may not be so badly impacted by the COVID-19, but certainly the economic impact is going to be significantly negative thanks to the this particular COVID pandemic. The recession is going to continue for the next 2-3 years globally, maybe even longer. Some of the economists are saying that it would be even longer than 2-3 years. Most of the countries, we are going to see negative growth, continued recessionary conditions, high rates of unemployment, and one of the worst part of the the whole of European continent is going to be very badly impacted, except maybe Germany and to some extent UK, but even UK nobody really knows. But most of the European countries are going to be very badly impacted by the prolonged recession, and the expectation or the fear is that the recession in Europe will continue for almost a decade, going up to 2030. So let me now talk about the impact on the Indian economy. The Indian economy is, anyway, we had seen, as I mentioned, significant slowdown in 2019, 2020 is going to be worst impacted. I think we are going to see negative GDP growth right up to end of third quarter. Hello.
Hello.
There's echoing. Gautam ma'am.
Gautam ma'am.
I got us. No, I am getting echoing voice.
I think Girish's audio is on.
The video is off.
Okay, can you hear me now? Now there is no echo. Okay, so we had, as I mentioned, we had already started seeing significant slowdown in 2019 itself, and now we are going to see a big negative impact of COVID on the GDP growth. The first quarter is going to be negative, second quarter is going to be negative growth, even the third quarter also may be negative growth, and maybe from January, the fourth quarter onwards, we may see some kind of a positive growth. So there are different numbers which are being thrown out by various economists. Initially, when the COVID impact started, people started saying the economic growth will, GDP growth will be around 1.5% to 2% positive. Some numbers even talked about 3% positive GDP growth. But now generally the consensus seems to be between negative or between 1.5% to 2.5% for financial year 2020-21. The impact of steps in terms of priming, then maybe we'll start seeing growth from, as I said, from the last quarter of the current financial year, and we may be from third quarter of 2021-22, we may see on the annualized basis 6 to 7% growth starting from the third quarter of 2021-22, or maybe even fourth quarter of 2021-22. So I think negative growth in the current year, subdued growth in financial year 21-22, and the real growth will start from financial year 22-23, provided, as I said, provided the Modi government really takes right effective steps to prime the Indian economy immediately after this COVID-19 crisis comes under control. My belief faster recovery in Indian economy as compared to the other economies is based on two things. One is a significantly high young proportion of young people. We have got that demographic advantage with more than 65% of India's population. More than 65% of India's population is based below the age of 35, which is good from the point of view of having a strong consumption demand, which is what is required. So that's the first point. The second point, which is related to this consumption demand, is the overall corporate debt and household debt, and more particularly the household debt, the Indian household debt as a percentage of the total GDP. If you look at India's household debt, it is 12% of GDP, one of the lowest in the G20 countries. And if you look at the household debt, Canada is highest at 102% of its GDP. France is 61%, China is 54%. UK is 84%, and these are the percentages as a percentages of GDP. And India, as I mentioned, is the lowest amongst the G20 countries. Even in terms of corporate debt, India, although we have a big problem in many of the corporate highly leveraged balance sheets, which you have all read in the press in terms of the matters which are pending at NCLT, but still overall corporate debt as a percentage of GDP, India has only 44%, again one of the lowest in the G20 countries. So if you look at the total private debt, that's the corporate debt and household debt, it's 56% of the total GDP, whereas in a country like Canada, it is 227%. France is 216%. China, which is the likely to be number one country very soon in terms of the overall size of the economy and GDP, it has also got very high corporate debt of 150%, household debt is 54%, so overall private debt is 204%. UK is 166%. Japan, which is the economy, which is an aging economy, has also got very high household debt of 59%, corporate debt is 103%, so overall 162%. So USA it is 150%, Germany it is still low 113%, and that's why I said Germany will be less impacted. So overall, two factors, as I said, the high demographic advantage of having a population below the age of 35, which is 65% of the total, 35 years is 65% of the population, and very low private debt in comparison with many other countries, can revive the economy very quickly if Modi government takes significant steps to prime up the economy very soon. Of course, against these two advantages that we have, we also have some problems which need to be resolved by the Modi government, and nobody else can do it. These problems need to be sorted out. Sorry, before I go to the problems, I must tell you, while we are looking at the overall debt, India also is in an advantageous position because a very high percentage of India's GDP, India has got very high savings rate. It's almost close to between 30% and 32%. It varies between 30% and 32% is in savings. Unfortunately, the Indian savings are locked in real estate and in gold. Now we can understand gold. We keep India is the highest importing country in the world, or consumption country in the, as far as consumption of gold is concerned, is the highest country. And next to oil, India's imports are in the form of gold. But the problem is in the investment in real estate, which is going to be a big problem for many Indians because of the likely decline in the real estate prices. We have already seen a significant decline, but beyond that, we are going to see further decline in the real estate prices. So those who have locked in the investments in the real estate should come out of real estate at the earliest, because you will see significant decline in the real estate prices, especially on the commercial sector. So the problems are weak financial services sector, which are really banking in particular. Insurance, of course, has been significantly privatized. However, the banking, even today, 70% of the total banking is in the hands of public sector banks, which are very weak. Though the consolidation is happening, but unless the government liberalizes the banking sector and privatizes it, there is going to be a big problem in terms of banking. And if we have to really see future growth in the Indian economy, then the Indian banking sector needs to be liberalized at the earliest. That's the first problem. The second problem is the weaker infrastructure. That's the other problem. And but that means there is an opportunity here. As they say, every problem has got an opportunity. So when we talk about weaker infrastructure, it also gives a significant potential for growth through what we commonly known as the Keynesian theory of general theory of employment, interest and money, which he propounded in early 30s. And that's something which was used by Western countries, and more particularly United States, after the World War II. And they invested heavily into infrastructure in 50s and 60s, and that's how US became such a powerful country, which was, of course, always was a powerful country, but became much more stronger than Europe. Especially the Western European countries also became strong because of the huge investments that they made in infrastructure. And what about China? If you see China, until 1978, both India and China were at the same level of economic growth. Between the two countries put together, the two countries accounted for hardly 2% or 3% of the overall GDP, global GDP. And then the liberalization started in China in 1979. And over the last 40 years, Chinese government successively have invested so much of money in infrastructure And then, of course, thanks to the initial demographic advantage that they had, the investment in infrastructure gave that multiplier and accelerator effect, which is what the Keynesian economy talks about. And the consumption demand increased, and that's how China has become one of the strongest countries in the world today. In fact, it's number two next to US and will become very soon. Needs to do in terms of investing significant money into infrastructure in roads, ports, airports, water connectivity, and generation of power, and so on and so forth. And there's a list which one can go on talking about, including improving the logistics, which will improve the supply chain management. So these are the some of the things where the Indian government needs to make huge investment, which will have opportunity in terms of job creation that will increase the demand, consumption demand, that will also increase the per capita income, and that will really start creating capacities. Today, if you look at... Hello? Today, if you look at the manufacturing capacities in the country, whichever sector you may take, the capacity utilization is hardly 60%. So there is a lot of unutilized capacity which is still lying to be kind of used, and that is something which will happen if the even if the consumption demand starts increasing. Nobody is going to set up a new capacity in the manufacturing sector, at least for the next 3 years. But if the consumption demand continues to increase every year, maybe from 2023 onwards, you will start companies going for increasing the capacity, which will again fuel the growth. The only one thing which most of the Indian companies need to take or keep it in mind is this time they should not plan their growth through cheap debt, which will be available, because Indian government, whether it is RBI or the finance ministry, are going to keep the interest rates comparatively lower. I'm talking comparatively lower in comparison with what we used to have in India. I'm not comparing with the rates of interest in the Western countries. So the availability of credit will be there, the interest rates will be cheap, and that should not kind of encourage the Indian companies to go for growth and expansion through leveraged balance sheet. They should try to put the money out of their own internal accruals or by infusion of their own equity, whether it is their own generated funds or through public equity, or even if necessary private equity. But there should be a good mix of equity and debt. Otherwise, going forward, if they have highly leveraged balance sheet, that can create really a big problem. So I think in my view, the utilization
video mainly audio mainly.
In my view, the liberalization of 91 gave us a growth for almost last 30 years, which kind of brought in India into the global field. The same kind of a growth, or maybe even higher growth, we should expect from now, at least from 2 years from now, going till 2050. So next 3 years, we should see the next phase of the growth. And I will call it, although COVID is a negative word, I'll call it as a post-COVID economic growth of India, which will bring India to number two position next to China and even higher than United States. As I mentioned, partly because of the demographic advantage that we have and partly because of the infrastructure investment. As I said, the demographic dividend, all economists call is that India has got a demographic dividend, but this dividend can become a huge liability if this kind of investment doesn't happen, because when you have the young population which is growing and which will continue to grow till at least 2050, if enough employment opportunities are not created, there could be a big social unrest issue. And therefore, this growth number which I talked about, 7% or whatever, has to be an India imperative. It has to be made possible. In fact, China for almost 35 years had more than 10% growth, close to 12% growth. Of course, we can say that China is not a democratic country, is a communist country, so it was possible to kind of have that kind of a growth. But even then, if there is a determined government and if the government takes the right policies, then I do not see as to why India should also not have a 10% growth year on year for at least 15 to 20 years out of these 30 years. And that can really solve the social unrest issue, which otherwise could be a big, big problem. Which also means that three things need to happen, because when you have the young growing population, there has to be affordable healthcare and affordable education, and then of course opportunities in terms of employment, employability, which including entrepreneurship and so on and so forth. So skill development is therefore really necessary, not the traditional skill development, but the skill development in the non-conventional areas. So that's what I believe is the changing face of Indian economy, and what I'm expecting in terms of the the changes in the Indian economy. Along with that, what I expect to happen in the Indian economy is the more use of technology in manufacturing plants at the shop floor level,
Nandit,
as compared to done ever. You know, we always used to say that India has got a low cost labor advantage, but many a times, especially when the labor laws are inflexible, it can become a big liability. And I'm giving you, I've spent other than my 5 years in IT when I was with Tata IBM, and maybe 10 years in financial services, I spent more than 20 years in the manufacturing sector. And removing labor in India is not so easy. There are strong unions, there are very tough labor laws, and therefore if you really, so far Indian employers or Indian entrepreneurs used to look at labor as a given kind of a issue. You've got permanent employees, you can't do anything. You've got contract employees, you can't do anything, because many times the contract labor also becomes very militant, and we have seen many such issues in many companies in India. And so therefore labor laws need to be changed. The inflexibility that is there today in labor laws needs to be removed. If that is removed, and I hope it is done, then you will find that Indian companies will go for significant amount of technology in the manufacturing areas, which is anyway going to happen in the services area. We are already experiencing it now, sitting here in the lockdown condition. You know, I must tell you that Gautam Amladi Ma'am, had talked to me about 3 months ago in the month of January that we should hold some CA conference in Bombay. And I said, yes, we should do it. And we were talking about, why don't we do it? Gautam Ma'am, you remember we were talking about doing it in Kharmat.
Why?
And I said, Ami Kharmat Hankarya, and you call all the chartered accountants and we'll have a kind of a first get together and we'll talk about what we can do working together, all the chartered accountants. That never happened. But now we're all sitting home, and digitally we are now what, almost close to 30 people are together. So that means the digital technology is now bringing us, COVID is bringing us bringing us together to adopt the digital technology faster than one could imagine. And in the services business, whether it's in financial services business, travel business, IT, of course, it was already happening. But one is going to see a very strong digital adoption or digital technology adoption, which is going to improve the Indian efficiency significantly. So both in manufacturing plants and as well as in services sector, the use of digital technology is going to see a high level of accelerated use, and that's going to bring in efficiency, that is going to bring down the overall cost of production, and people will start working from residences. Companies will say, you know, why should I have 100,000? I heard somebody's working in Accenture, somebody's working in Sharath Ma'am is working in Deloitte, somebody said he's working in Ernst & Young. And people will say, those who are in the knowledge business or knowledge industry, they will say that why do I need to have 200,000 square feet offices. Maybe people should be allowed to work from the residences. The efficiency improves, and you know, any case, we are servicing clients who are abroad, so they can operate from the residence. I can bring down the office size from 200,000 square feet to maybe only about 50,000 square feet, just to have the essential staff. And once in a while, I'll allow these people to come to my office. So you are going to see that kind of a significant change in the operation, the way we operate. And that's why I mentioned the real estate prices are going to crash significantly, especially in the commercial properties. Already we have high supply of real estate in the marketplace. The demand anyway had come down, will further go down. I see younger generation who would say, oh, I don't want to buy any house or flat. I would prefer to stay in a rented premises, because anyway, if I were to invest in a new flat, I have to invest even in distant suburb. I have to invest at least 1.5 to 2 crores. And at the rate of interest of 8%, I am spending at least 16 lakh rupees per year in terms of interest. Whereas my same property, I can take it on rental for less than 4 lakh rupees in kind of a rent per annum, or 3 lakh rent per annum. So why should I go for buying a property? And I don't even know whether I'll be working in Bombay. I may be posted to Bangalore, or I may be posted to somewhere in the world. Anyway, I want to go to the US. So why should I block in my investment buying a flat? So you will find the commercial real estate as well as the residential real estate prices coming down significantly. It never happened in India. All these years we used to say invest in gold and invest in land, then invest in flats. Now you're going to find for the first time after maybe more than 50-60 years that the real estate prices are going to go down, as we see what happened in the Western world. It has happened in most of the European countries as well as in the US. So this is what is going to see, we are going to see as a kind of a changing world as far as the Indian economy is concerned. What does it mean to the chartered accountants, whether chartered accountants in practice or chartered accountants in service? Now, before I do that, I would like to take a pause and would like to have, if there are any questions on whatever I have spoken so far. Is that okay, Gautam ma'am?
Yes, Sandeep. Yeah, sure. Posted a question. Sandeep Bhatt.
Praveen ma'am, I had a question, and that is to do with the priming of the economy. You know, the always there's been a problem of priming up, whether it is the US or in India. And priming means that you either print money or you issue bonds. And what really happens is your position in terms of your grading, your rating goes down, and there's a fear right now that the BBB rating for India might go down even further to junk rate, and in which case it'll be a, you know, higher problem for us. So what's your feeling on that?
No, it's possible that the Indian rating will be classified from BBB to whatever. BBB, even if they keep maybe negative outlook, or then they will go to BB or whatever. So we may get into the junk category as far as investment grade is concerned. So what does it mean as far as Indian government is concerned? I think there are, first of all, you know, when the companies start doing very badly, they first look at internally what I can do. So I can give you some of the examples which we did in company, like in a big company like Tata Motors, when we ran into a similar problem in the late 90s, early 2000. All of us have got, you know, when we, I'm first giving an example of a company, and the same example is also true with the Indian government. So we have a lot of assets on our balance sheet which are not utilized or underutilized. So you need to take a call whether these assets are useful or not useful, and you need to sell them off, dispose them off, and get cash. So let's look at the India's, now let me come back to the Indian economy. And I'll come to the printing of fresh currency later. So first is we have got so many investments made by Indian government in the public sector companies. So I have got a case like a company which is in public sector making lubricants. Why should Indian government be making lubricants, which are, this is tough competition from Castrol. I'm giving an example of our Durgesh Chandavarkar ma'am, who has invested in a company called Tidewater. His company has got 30% holding in company like Tidewater. Now Tidewater is competing with Castrol, where Uday Gurkar ma'am said he was also working. Now Castrol is a private sector company holding number one position for last at least 35-40 years. What business Indian government has to have investment in a company like Tidewater? I did mention earlier about banking sector. See, if Indian government continues to hold 51% shareholding in Indian banks, which have got 70% of the Indian banking sector is controlled by them, we are going to have a problem, because we have got the CAG audits, we have got all these corruptions and so on and so forth. A bank chairman, even a State Bank of India chairman, managing director, such a powerful position, and we have had so far brilliant CMDs in State Bank of India right from the beginning. I mean, when you look at each and every CMD of State Bank of India over the last 50 years, each one of them individually has been a brilliant banking professional. Today, a CMD of State Bank of India gets only 30 lakh rupees as his total compensation. So how will you invite meritocracy into banking? That's why the corruption takes place. Then you have got CAG audits. So Indian government needs to divest and do the disinvestment as early as possible. For the last more than 15 years, there have been in the every finance budget, the finance minister makes very tall and ambitious plans of, you know, we'll collect so many crores, thousands of crores to disinvestment program. Each year the program fails miserably in terms of implementation. But this time onwards, the government should really look at it seriously in terms of this whole disinvestment program. That's where the Indian government can get significant cash. The second thing is the very strong drive in terms of collection of direct taxes and indirect taxes, which is basically GST. Now with your Aadhaar and with all the, and I mentioned about use of technology and linkaging everything from personal tax to GST to your banking transaction, which is what the government is doing, then the significant leakages which are taking place will get kind of a, hopefully kind of a get caught if there are any leakages which are happening. And this is where Indian government needs to improve their collection efficiency. Collection efficiency should not be there by just issuing some irrelevant notices. I saw in the our CA, Bhanup CA WhatsApp group, the recent advance authority kind of a, what should I say, pronouncement that full-time directors of a company are liable to pay GST. That means, why full-time directors? Then every employee in the company should be liable to pay GST, because you can't then distinguish a full-time director from an ordinary employee of the company. This is a ridiculous judgments. Now, government should ensure that the whole tax administration literally, or rather really, follows the tax administration very efficiently. And through the technology which I mentioned earlier, and our Nandan Nilekani ma'am has done extremely good job, we should really ensure that the collection of taxes is timely, efficient, and we really catch wherever there are real leakages. If that happens, that's the second source of revenue generation. The third generation revenue generation is or inflow is what Bajpayee government did in late 90s when Pokhran nuclear test was kind of announced, and the Western countries, all the Western countries, put embargo on India, and we were really suffering at that time. So what did Bajpayee government do? They brought the NRI money. Of course, it was expensive. In those days, the bond was attracting 9%. US dollar bond was attracting 9%. But there is enough money outside from the NRIs will kind of happily put in the money. You can raise good amount of money. You may have to pay slightly higher rate of interest, but that is something which the Indian government will have to do. So what I'm trying to say is, before printing the new fresh notes and increasing the deficit, you will have to really look at these kind of steps you'll have to take. Fortunately, the oil prices are down, and oil prices will continue to be down for at least next 2 to 3 years, at least 2 years. That will ease down the problem on the trade deficit. So that will help in terms of bridging the gap on the trade deficit side. Dollar will remain strong. Dollar will be between 75 to 80 rupees, will stabilize at 80 rupees. And therefore, if Indian exporters, if they really improve, and I'm going to come to that point, that Indian exporters need to really take the advantage of the devaluing Indian rupee and try to improve their exports. And not just only in the IT related exports. Of course, Indian manufacturing exports are also strong, but they need to really improve their strength in Indian exports, which means reducing the cost. And I'll come to that cost part later in terms of what chartered accountants can do. But what I'm trying to say is, the if the oil prices remain under control, and you have got strong exports thanks to rupee devaluation, not done by RBI but happening through the trade mechanism, then I think the export will grow and the trade deficit will be under control. And the next item is the flow of capital into India. I think and you have read recently, just a couple of days ago, that Japanese government has told their industry to take out the whatever they have done in terms of, you know, there's a huge Japanese investment in China, and there is a big risk which the Japanese companies are expecting, and that's where Japanese companies are looking to reduce their dependence, shift their manufacturing outside of China. And this is where India should really work very closely with Japanese government, as it is, there's a trade pact which has been signed between Japanese Prime Minister, Indian Prime Minister about a year and a half ago. Taking the advantage of that trade pact, there should be active encouragement given by the Prime Minister or by the Indian government to bring in that investment into India. You will find a lot of money coming into India, what we talk about, the investment money coming into India on the capital account, that will also help the bridging the gap. So unlike what happened in the late 90s, where Indian economy was liberalized, but still not as much as what it is today, we are not going to see the same kind of a situation. So things are going to improve. We will see a lot of money coming in on trade account as well as on the capital account, and therefore I feel that even if there is a junk status given to our paper, it may not be such a big problem. And that's where the government, as I said more than three four times in my last half an hour talk, that it is very important that the Indian government this time really takes very effective steps in priming the Indian economy.
Thank you, Praveen ma'am. It was an excellent summary of the way ahead, and I can only add, it's the positive side which we should be looking at rather than the negative side. And I for one feel that it's much more advantageous for India to replace the Chinese economy with our goods and services, and that will be great for India. And as you rightly said, subject to the Indian government working on it. Absolutely true.
See, I'll tell you the other point I would like to make is, now there have been some speculation has been going on that this coronavirus, is it a new nuclear bomb or nuclear arsenal which was brought in by China? Now there are a lot of speculation going on, and some discussion is also going on whether we should sue the Chinese government. I don't know where will you sue, in the international court in Hague, and I don't know where it will take and what will happen. So it is meaningless to take China to international court. But what I'm trying to say is that in the whole process of this coronavirus, there is a lot of distrust amongst many countries with regard to China. There is a distrust in Chinese economy, China in the country, and dependence on China is going to get reduced significantly. China today runs trade surplus with almost the whole world. Every country in the world has got trade deficit vis-a-vis China, or the other way, China has got trade surplus with many countries, and that's going to be taken by each country as a big threat, and therefore countries across the globe will look for alternate supplies, and this is where an opportunity lies for India to step into the shoes of Chinese manufacturers. And I was coming to that point later in terms of what Chinese arising out of this, what Indian companies need to do. And this is the golden opportunity for India to really become a supplier to the world of goods. Anyway, in services, we have done a good job, but in manufacturing, we are still not doing that good job. But this is an opportunity to become a supplier to the world or global economy on the manufacturing side. So that's an opportunity. Any other question?
Sachin Ubhekar had wanted to ask a question. Sachin.
Hi, Praveen. And I wanted to have your views that the post IL&FS, as it is, you are seeing the stress in the NBFC segment. Now, with the economic lockdown which is there, do you think there's a risk of some of the NBFCs facing both liquidity and solvency issue, and that posing a systemic risk to the overall financial system?
Yes, in fact, it's going to be a big problem. In fact, I was talking to some of my old colleagues from Tata Capital, and I've been also talking to some of the other NBFC company CEOs, and they all have been telling that on the one side, Reserve Bank has told these NBFCs and banks to have given extended moratorium or extended payment terms or overlook the defaults and give them more time or more moratorium. But the definition of recognizing the NPA, there is still no liberalization done by Reserve Bank of India. So these companies are going to, NBFCs in particular, are going to have a problem. In fact, you will see significant consolidation happening in the NBFC sector. Only those companies who are brought in by strong promoters, who have got, the promoter should have very strong ratings, or NBFCs which have got strong balance sheets, only they will survive. So you will see a big consolidation happening in the NBFC sector. I already mentioned that consolidation is happening in the public sector banks, and but just consolidation in public sector banks is not good enough. They also need to be given a lot of capital, so that's going to be another challenge for Indian government. And similar consolidation you will see happening in the NBFC sector. Even a company like Bajaj Finance has already gone on record, and they've given in their presentation three scenarios in terms of what happens if it is business as usual immediately after the COVID crisis takes place, is brought under control, then no issue. But they have also gone into the, and they have been very transparent in making a presentation to, they put it on their website, you can perhaps go also and check that under different scenario how their numbers will look like. So it is going to be a problem for NBFC sector. And Reserve Bank will have to do a lot of support. Reserve Bank will have to give to them.
And second question I have is that government already has exceeding the fiscal deficit. So a lot of industry and even economists are clamoring for a stimulus. Do you think actually the government has a scope to do a disproportionate fiscal stimulus like what Canada, US, or even Japan has done, where the fiscal stimulus is almost ranging between 10 to 20% of the GDP to get the economy out of this forced shutdown?
Yes, I think Indian government, there was some statistical data which came about 3-4 days ago. Indian stimulus is hardly 2% or between 2% and 3% of the GDP, whereas most of the countries have gone beyond 10%. Some of them even have gone up to 15-20%, as you said. I think we will have to go between 5-10%. Going beyond 10% immediately may be a problem. So between 5-10% is something which Indian government will have to do in terms of providing the stimulus. As I said, just giving stimulus is not good enough. I mentioned 3-4 steps which Indian government needs to do or take, like improving the tax collection efficiency, disinvestment program, looking for alternate source of money from outside, attracting the foreign investment. If these 4-5 steps are taken, then both on capital and revenue account, the collections will improve, and that will hopefully, but again, you are right, it cannot happen immediately. There is a lag. So these things will take about a year and a year and a half to happen. But in the meantime, Indian government will have to loosen their purse and go up to maybe close to 8-9% or 10% of the GDP to be provided by way of a stimulus.
And last question, you have run a auto components company. So today, most of the manufacturing have a complex and long supply chain. Now that the economy is shut for 21 days, do you think even after the companies are started to set up that entire supply chain will take anywhere between 2-3 quarters?
Yeah, okay. Good question. In fact, I am facing this problem every day. We have a managing director, but I am active chairman in that company. So our auto component business is close to $1 billion. We have 42 plants, out of which 35 plants are in India, and 34 plants in India and 8 plants outside of India. What is happening is today it's a situation where we have to conserve cash. Because Mr. Modi has said, you know, you can't remove the employees. So fine, you can't remove the employees. We have to pay the salaries. But can we defer the payment of salaries? So we are looking at, suppose 20% or 30% of the salaries are deferred, are converted into, now we are part of Tata's, we will say, okay, fine, we can't cut the salaries immediately. It will be very unfair. So we are saying, okay, can I convert it into a 2 years, or 3 years deferred payment, salary deferred payment plan, and we'll give them interest maybe at the rate of 8%, 9%, 10%. We are working on it. We're talking with the unions. So that's one part. We are talking to suppliers in terms of kind of reducing the, not converting the immediate payment into long-term payments, maybe 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, again with rate of interest. Now each negotiating with each supplier, either domestic or international, is an issue. And just as we have problems, they also have problems. So why we are doing this, coming to your point, is because we don't know how long this COVID situation will continue. Even if, let's say, on 30th April, if the lockdown is lifted, the real production will start from 1st of June. And I must tell you, in automobile, you know, who are our customers? All the big OEM companies like Tata Motors, Ashok Leyland, Toyota, Maruti, Hyundai, Daimler, and so on, Eicher, Volvo, and so on and so forth. You see, the discretionary purchases, which is basically passenger cars, these are discretionary purchases. If my job is not sure, or if I am going to ask my company to take 20% cut or 20% deferred payment in my salary, why would I go and buy a car? I won't. I'll wait. So this is discretionary purchase. So there is going to be a significant drop in the consumption demand on the car side, at least in the next 6 to 9 months. And that's why I said you will not see economy getting into positive zone, at least the manufacturing part, at least till end of December. So I will not go and buy a car. Now let's look at buying a truck. Now, unlike buying a car, which is discretionary purchase, buying a truck is a commercial decision. Only if there is enough demand in terms of cargo carrying the cargo and the rentals in the cargo carriage thing goes up, the rental rates. Right now the rental rates are depressed because nobody is going for a moment of anything, any cargo. So today, if any cargo is to be moved from Bombay to Pune, there will be 100 truck operators will be ready to come and tell you, okay, ye le lo. If the normal rates were, say, 25,000 or 30,000 rupees for the journey, they will now say, okay, even 10,000 I'm ready to shift, so long as I recover my variable cost, or even maybe some part of variable cost. So it's a commercial decision to buy a truck. If the manufacturing is going to be depressed, nobody is going to buy a new truck. So the old trucks will be used more. So you will find that the truck demand is also going to be negative. And so the actual demand for both trucks and cars will really start, you will start seeing it if, as I mentioned, if Modi government primes the economy, demand starts picking up on the movement, then only people will go and start buying the, and there is an assurance on the job front, then one will go and buy the trucks and the cars. We have always seen that two-wheelers are an exception. So you will see that maybe two-wheeler demand will pick up, because two-wheeler is a last mile kind of a commuting vehicle. So from that point of view, two-wheeler demand will start showing some growth, but not the way it used to be there maybe 12 months, 18 months ago. After 25 years, two-wheeler demand saw negative growth in financial year 1920. Whereas the last 25, it was only one way. The curve was only going up. Sorry, not 25 years, 20 years. It was, the curve was only going up. So but that is what will be seen again, maybe from July, August onwards on the two-wheeler side. So coming to the component side and the OEM, it's going to be tough days for most of the companies. Did I answer your question? Hello?
Sachin?
Come on, sir. Yeah, my questions are answered.
Okay. Ravin, ma'am. Gurudat Manjeshwar wants to ask a question. Gurudat, ma'am, you can unmute yourself and ask. Gurudat, ma'am, we joined in late. Hello, Gurudat, ma'am. Hello. Okay, Rohan, you wanted to ask something?
Hi, Praveen, ma'am. So, as you just mentioned, that disinvestment is definitely a source of revenue from the government angle. But considering there were a lot of scams in private sector as well, so to develop a investor faith, so what should be the ideal mix actually? Should it be 100% disinvestment, or there should be a mix of government and privatization actually?
No, the point is, scams have happened that has nothing to do with the disinvestment program. So the scams which have happened, in fact, I was going to come to that point, the what chartered accountants, practicing chartered accountants can do, and the CAs who are in industry can do, is basically a very strong compliance culture needs to be brought in, and the transparency needs to be improved. And I'll come to that point later. But just to answer your question, just because the scams have taken place doesn't mean that disinvestment should not happen. Disinvestment should happen. In fact, Nirmala Sitharaman, the finance minister, in the budget speech announced that she would like to do LIC to be made public. And that happens, then there is a big revenue, not revenue, big inflow of capital getting into the government treasury. Of course, getting LIC listed is not going to be an easy thing. Right from the, we'll have to do so many things, right from changing the constitution of LIC, and then because it's a kind of a trust today, from trust to a public enterprise, that too under Indian Companies Act, and then kind of a gets its books brought under the Indian Companies Act, and then getting it listed, plus corporate governance. And again, there are some skeptics who say that there are a lot of holes. If you really open and unravel the balance sheet of LIC, there'll be a lot of holes you will find. We don't know really the truth, because it's been always a black box all these years. But but if it really happens and government of India successfully takes LIC public, government will get huge amount of money. So disinvestment, and I gave you a couple of examples earlier, disinvestment has to be done, and it has nothing to do with scams which have taken place in private sector. I mean, ILFS scam is not in private sector. ILFS was completely owned by almost 80-90% was owned by Indian government. I mean, the public sector banks. So there was, of course, investment by HDFC Bank also. But I'm just saying that, rather HDFC, not HDFC Bank. But I'm saying that the scams have nothing to do with this investment program. Public-private partnership will be required, especially when it comes to infrastructure investment. In the past, government had tried that example or other model in the road construction. In the first phase during the Bajpayee government's time, the public-private participation in road construction was a successful exercise. However, subsequently during the UPA government and also in the first term of Modi government, the public-private participation has not really worked. So one will have to really look at public-private participation in infrastructure project. The whole model will have to be looked separately, differently, to make it successful.
Thank you.
Gurudatna, you can ask your question. Hello, Gurudat Manjeshwar.
If there is no other question, can I move forward?
No, ek Gurudat ma malasila. He was no. Okay, I'll ask on his turn. Hai ghalle hajari. I'll ask it on.
Okay, so I will now talk about what does it mean to the chartered accountants.
Pravin ma.
And
1 second.
Sorry.
Gurudat Manjeshwar had a question.
He says, okay.
He has put it on the chat. China has invested many more in many countries, in Africa,
yes.
European countries also. And even if we don't rely on imports from purchases from China itself. Secondly, Indian pharma companies are heavily dependent on imports in China. Your views, please. That's what I'm asking.
Yeah, that's true. The whole African continent, unfortunately, has been captured by China. The whole, if you look at ports, roads, airports, power projects, water resources projects in the whole of African continent and South Africa is, there is not that much of investment, but other than South Africa, almost the entire African continent is fully captured by China. And they're very shrewd because they believe that the next growth, which past 2050, the growth is going to come from African continent. So keeping that long-term view, they have made huge investments in the African continent. And that's very unfortunate part. The other unfortunate part is there is no single country in Africa where there's a strong democracy. And that is also one of the reasons, because most of the country there has been strong dictatorship, and the Chinese government captured them in a way. There's a huge corruption. You can understand what I'm trying to say. And the leaders made money, the dictators in African countries made money. It was easy for the Chinese government to really make these investments, and today whole African continent and to some extent in Europe also. I mean, Italy is a very classic example. Now they say why Italy has had this big problem of COVID was because the whole Italian manufacturing sector, the fashion sector, the banking sector is captured by Chinese investment. And that's why that Yuan province, a lot of the Chinese came to Italy, because there has been a lot of manufacturing which happens for Italian companies, or Italian companies are controlled by these people from Yuan province. And that's why COVID first came to this virus came to Italy. So, as I said, the investments in Europe are going to haunt them, the local countries, and it's difficult for them to, as you rightly said, difficult to kind of dislodge them so easily. Many European countries are now understanding and are now putting the restrictions in terms of how much to allow this foreign investment, especially investments coming from China. So there is going to be, what last 30 years we saw globalization, we are now going to see deglobalization in European countries especially. Indian government has been always very cautious in terms of allowing the Chinese investments coming in. And so that cautious approach will continue. US, after Mr. Trump took over, has ensured that in many critical areas of economy, he has not allowed the Chinese investment to come in. So, but whatever has happened in the past, that negative impact will continue in terms of export of products from China or manufacturing in local countries by the Chinese owners. That will continue. But there's still a lot of scope for especially Indian companies to capture the market which will be available to them.
Yeah, Pravinam, there are no further questions. At least
okay.
Nobody has indicated anymore.
So let me now talk about what are the opportunities available to the chartered accountants, whether they are in practice or in profession. One, of course, immediate opportunities. Most of these SME sector companies are going to be badly impacted by this COVID crisis, which would mean whether you are in practice, and most perhaps the people who are in practice today and practice beyond just the audit, statutory audit kind of a practice. And I suggest that most of you who are in practice should not only continue to be in statutory audit, but also get into management audit very quickly and try to help these companies, because most of these companies need to be revived very badly. They are very badly hurt. Some of them may be on the brink of collapse. And therefore, you need to really help them in terms of how these companies can be revived, how their costs can be brought down, how their rationalization can be done in terms of their operations, how the cash flow position can be improved. And this is something which is an immediate kind of a opportunity for practicing chartered accountants. If you are working with these small enterprises or medium enterprises as a CFO or whatever position you are holding, this is where there is an opportunity. And I think one should really look at this particular opportunity very quickly. The other point which is going to be helping is, and this is something I was going to bring this point later, but I'll bring it earlier. Most of the companies will like to go for converting their fixed cost into variable cost. And what we call as the, how you can variabilize your cost. And this is something what all of us as a practicing chartered accountants or those who are in employment should really look at how we can variabilize our cost. So if the labor laws are kind of made flexible, you can in fact variabilize the entire labor cost. You can do your entire IT infrastructure by giving to even if you are small or whatever it is, by converting your fixed IT cost into variable IT cost. Your power cost today, by having and there are options available, maybe not as big as what one would like to have, but there are opportunities which are available where you can go for renewable energy power project which are based on renewable energy, and you can buy based on the use of whatever units you buy for your manufacturing. So that's the another area. Sale of assets and taking it on lease is going to be another area. Operating lease will become, and we have this, whatever it is called at AS 16 or accounting standard, it's but operating lease is going to be very important thing in terms of pay per usage, and then don't invest yourself into fixed assets, whether they're plant and machinery or IT equipment or whatever equipments, including cars and vehicles. Just go on the lease basis, preferably on the operating lease basis. The other area where you can really look at in terms of variabilization will be outsourcing. Whether you can outsource your HR function. Somebody mentioned that, I think it was Burde Mom, I think, who mentioned that his wife is providing the CFO kind of a service or accounting service. Accounting services, HR services, whatever can be outsourced, companies will look for that outsourcing, and this is something where these are the opportunities which are available. I must tell you, you know, outsourcing has no limit. It's not just in finance and HR, but even I'm talking about my experience in auto business. We all need to maintain, when we sell our cars or trucks or whatever we sell, we need to give 3 years warranty. I mean, in the past, it used to be 1 year warranty. Now we give 2 years warranty, 3 years warranty, sometimes even 5 year warranty. And we need to maintain detailed records. We find that maintaining these records for 2 years, 3 years, 5 years is becoming a big job. And many OEM companies are outsourcing this. So this is another area where you maintain the records for the OEM companies. And you need to maintain the records for in terms of how many man hours have been spent, what is the spare part cost, and so on and so forth. So this is also another area of outsourcing. So the limit to do outsourcing is going to, it's going to be unlimited kind of a opportunity. So this is where again we can kind of get into variabilization opportunity. Then there is a cost of logistics. Supply chain is going to be an important aspect of any manufacturing area. So rather than companies maintaining their own logistics department and managing the supply chain in-house, it will be completely outsourced. A company like TVS Logistics, a part of the TVS group, is already having revenue of more than 6,000 crores. It's providing service not only in India, but also in export and import. So you don't need to maintain these kind of a departments. Of course, they do it for big companies, but I'm saying even smaller companies will look for completely outsourcing the whole supply chain management. You don't need to invest in warehouses. You don't need to invest in vehicles. You don't need to invest in people or technology and so on and so forth. So that's how you can variabilize your costs. So in the past, typically in a typical manufacturing company, 55 to 60% would be raw material cost. And if you've got 10% margin and maybe 2, 3% or 4% will be interest and another 4% will be depreciation, at least 20 to 25% would be your fixed cost. Now, efforts will be made by many companies as to how to variabilize your cost and to bring it down from 25-30% to maybe only 10% and bring the fixed cost only to 10% and convert the remaining 20 odd percentage cost into variabilization. And this is an opportunity where chartered accountants who are working in the companies can identify the opportunities for their companies. Chartered accountants who are in practice can become outsourcing partners for the companies in terms of variabilization of costs. So this is the opportunity. Apart from, you know, the immediate impact of negative impact of the COVID, where you can really improve the cost side, identify the revenue growth opportunities, cash flow management, the free cash flow concept, which many people don't either underestimate or don't understand or don't implement, even if they understand, is going to be a very key important thing in terms of how the free cash flow can be brought into the into operations. And therefore, in the free cash flow, if you really want to have a very strong free cash flow, then you will see that capex spending or capital expenditure spending becomes an important issue in terms of managing the free cash flow, and therefore dependence on capital expenditure will be reduced. I'm not saying you will not buy capital expenditure, you will buy it or you will use it without owning it. And this is where the leasing operations, especially the operating leasing operations, will become important. So that's another opportunity in India. At least I know only one or two companies which are in operating leasing business in India, but otherwise no companies are in the operating leases. So that's an opportunity for chartered accountants to work for operating lease companies, or if you can generate capital or if you have access to some promoters, you can really suggest that the operating lease will be a best idea too in the new situation, new markets. In advanced countries like US, Japan and all that, operating lease is very common. I mean, it's not just for the aircrafts or for the engines of the aircrafts, but it is common for every damn thing which is done, used in the manufacturing to services business or even family managed businesses. So that's the how you can do the variabilization of the cost. The third opportunity which is available is the business continuity assurance. And this is something which I would strongly recommend to all the practicing chartered accountants, that the business continuity assurance, you have got tax practice, you have got audit practice, you have got management consultancy practice, but I think there are two practices which practicing chartered accountants should really look at. Big four firms are definitely going to use it. And I would say that business continuity should be looked at by all the small and medium chartered accountancy firms. And what does it mean in terms of business continuity? Business promoters. But are they sure that their money which they have lent to them, is it going to be kind of a return back? Will the interest be serviced, loan be serviced? And therefore, they may insist on some kind of a business continuity audit done by independent chartered accountants, not by statutory auditors, by independent chartered accountants. Because when you do the statutory audit, you may, as per the regulations now, as per the institute's regulations, you are not required to do other audits. So you will find that this kind of a practice, the assurance practice, will be open to many chartered accounting firms, which means, you know, how strong is the client's balance sheet, whether they have got the right product, whether they have got the right technology, whether they have got competition, and how good that company is equipped to face the competition. Do they have the necessary technology? Are they investing in the proper R&D? Similarly, are they looking at diversifying their risk by not looking at only few customers, but they are looking at more customers in India? Are they getting into the export market? And therefore, are they kind of looking at the export opportunities? So, are they looking at the competition, new emerging technologies, looking at the customer preferences? Are they looking at the regulatory framework which will not impact their business? Are they looking at geopolitical environment? All of this is what I call as the business continuity assurance model. And this is something which going forward, the lenders will require. The owners themselves may ask you to kind of do that kind of an audit. If you are working in a company, your promoter will ask you, can you do this from my business continuity point of view? Can you do this work for me? So this is going to be a big practice available, big opportunity available for chartered accountants working in practice, also for the chartered accountants who are in industry. This is related to also the second point which I was going to bring, was the enterprise risk management. I heard somebody saying, I'm looking after the enterprise risk management on behalf of one of the big four firms. Yes, this is a big business opportunity even for the small and medium chartered accounting firms, in terms of whether your client has got a proper ERM model in place. I mean, if your company is listed anyway, it's now going to be made mandatory to have the ERM in place, and the auditors are required to comment on it. So from the business continuity along with enterprise risk management is another opportunity which is available to the chartered accountants. I think both practicing chartered accountants as well as those who are in industry should really look at it. If there is a model which is I know all the big four firms are looking at this ERM practice, but one model which I saw was from KPMG. The three levels of defenses: one is from the ERM point of view, one is, of course, you put the strong internal processes and review internally the management reviews the first is putting the process of enterprise risk management. That's an opportunity available to practicing chartered accountants. Also opportunity available to the chartered accountants working in the company, looking at the whole enterprise risk management and putting the processes in place. The second thing is the management review. That's the second line of defense. So management periodically will review the risk. The identification of risk will happen with a high, low, medium. High risk will be reviewed by the management almost every month, or maybe more than once in a month. The medium will be maybe once in a quarter or once in 6 months, and low will be maybe once in a year or maybe once in 2 years. So that's the management review. The third one is, of course, the defense is the audit to be done by the internal auditor or by statutory auditors. So this is one area which will be available for the chartered accountants in the enterprise risk management. I talked about the third area is the tax management, efficient tax management. I did talk about in the question answer session that it's going to be one of the biggest opportunities available for the chartered accountants, and just not filing the return, looking after the assessments or appeals. First of all, A, convince your clients that they need to be tax compliant, they need to have transparency, otherwise there's going to be big penalty, imprisonment, criminal offenses. Right from filing of the return till kind of a completing the whole management process efficiently is going to be an opportunity available to both practicing chartered accountant as well as the people who are in the service. The other area of which not many chartered accountants in practice do it, though chartered accountants who are in industry, working in industry, work in that area, but this is one area, and I'm going to talk about the forex management. The currency risk, not many chartered accountants unfortunately spend time, and I'm going to say that the currency risk management or forex management is going to be one of the key areas going forward as Indian economy becomes fully integrated. Exports will increase, imports will also increase, and you got foreign currency debts on your balance sheet. You will be operating maybe in multi currencies and not only in one currency like dollar. Dollar, of course, will continue to be the currency for the whole globe, will remain to be strong currency. I expect euro to be devalued significantly. British pound also may suffer. We don't know about Japanese yen, but I'm saying dollar will continue to be strong. But what I'm trying to say is this whole currency management, the risk management on the currency side, is an opportunity for many practicing chartered accountants, which they should really be look at. I am not going to talk about forensic audit, because forensic audit is an opportunity which is available, because banks and the investors will continue to look at forensic audits to be done, where they have either lent the money or they're going to lend the money or going to invest the money. So tax management, risk management on forex side. The next item where I think there's a big opportunity is the strategic cost management. I mentioned earlier that India has the opportunity to become a manufacturer for the world, which used to be so far the prerogative of Chinese manufacturers and suppliers. And China had a huge advantage on the cost side. Many times the subsidies were given, cost subsidies were given by the Chinese government. I'm just giving an example like electricity. You will find that, and whenever we used to make the comparison in cases wherever when I was with Tata Motors or now in Auto Component, we used to do the comparison of manufacturing costs of Chinese manufacturers, and we used to find that China would subsidize the electricity cost like anything. So if you want to become a world manufacturer or a manufacturer for the globe, then you really need to look at your entire cost management, and that's why I call this as a strategic cost management. So first is raw material. I think 1% cost reduction on the raw material side, those days are gone. So you need to now look at 5 to 10% cost reduction. How can I do it? How can I do it by way of import substitution, material substitution? I'm not talking about the traditional negotiation, but import substitution by indigenizing the production, material substitution by looking at alternate sources of material or alternate material itself, not just the source. The logistics cost, how can I bring it down? The packaging cost of material which comes in, how can I bring it down? So which means the overall supply chain cost, how can I bring it down? How can I do the efficient manufacturing, which we talked about, the kind of manufacturing to be completely technology oriented and highly and reducing the dependence on labor. So that's going to be the second part. So improving the employee productivity. The third thing is the zero cost budgeting. We all studied this in our theory, but this is now the time where to look at how we can bring down the question each and every element of cost. Don't say this is a fixed cost means fixed cost, I can't do anything. Look at each and every cost and treat that each item of fixed cost is a discretionary cost. And can I remove it? Can I reduce it? And even if I had to incur it, what are the alternate kind of options that I have to bring down that fixed cost. So zero cost budgeting. Then I also talked about the variabilization of cost. So this is, I call it as a strategic cost management. I talked about the cost of logistics, the space cost. All of us, especially companies which are in business of services, they will be looking at space costs quite seriously, because we have this typical rental agreements for 25 years. Every 3 years, you will increase the rent by 15%. Now, in reality, the rates are going to go down. So you will have to come out of some of these agreements if possible. If there is no lock-in, you will have to come out. So I think the space costs, how we can reduce the space cost, is going to be key important thing from the point of view of doing the strategic cost management. The other one is the efficient working capital management. How can you bring down the inventory? How you can bring down the receivables? You will have to perhaps improve the reduce the working capital or reduce the receivables by doing the factoring. Now, I understand that as per accounting standards, if there's a recourse available to you, then you can't show it as you will have to still show as receivable. But this is something which you will have to really work on in terms of how you can kind of bring down the receivables. You will have to give maybe cash discount. I've seen many times people give cash discount, but they say, okay, my cost of borrowing is 8%, 9%, maybe 10%. So my cash discount will be equivalent to 10% on annualized basis. No, you should not. You should look at your overall cost of equity or overall cost of weighted average cost of capital, which is equity cost plus borrowing cost. So if you really look at it, your weighted average cost of capital is 15%, 16%. So why can't I give equivalent of 1.5% discount or 2% discount by way of a cash discount if the customer is going to pay me immediately? So that will bring down your receivables. The other thing is, when we talk about working capital management, many a times I've seen the problems of companies start when they use working capital for long-term investments. This is where the diversion takes place. And then you are always saying, you know, I've got banking lines of credit, so therefore it's a free money, because that's money available to me anytime. It's a line of credit made available to me, and therefore I can kind of invest it in long term. In the meantime, it's a kind of a bridge financing, and I will 6 months later or a year later, I'll bring some permanent capital, which will be again a debt only, not equity. So this is where, but then things change, and the change is going to be much faster than what it used to be earlier, and you will not have enough time to bring in long term capital, and you are stuck. You're stuck with the diversion of working capital for long term investments. So this is again that discipline which needs to be brought in, and managing this working capital, how the companies are managing as a part of management audit. This is something which is available to you in terms of doing the management audit for practicing chartered accountant. If you are working in the companies, you can help the management in identifying the problems in your working capital management and sorting out those problems. Those who are in practice, technology is going to play an important role. You know, if I am an entrepreneur and you come to me as a statutory auditor and ask me to increase the fees every year, and I am looking at reduction in my cost, all the fixed costs, and I'll say, yes, I have to get my books audited by a statutory auditor, but why should I give you every year 5%, 7%, 10% increase? Okay, I understand my volume has gone up, but I also need to see some efficiency from your side. You need to give me audited statements. Yes, I'll do everything from my accounting point, everything I'll keep it ready, but then you need to give me audited accounts in 3 weeks. The moment I give you the accounts, within 2 weeks or 3 weeks, you need to complete the audit. Now, how will you do it? And this is where you will have to use technology. This is where you will have to look at tools like artificial intelligence, machine learning, even robotics. Let me give an example, especially those who are in tax practice. A firm like Amarchand Mangal Das, you all know, this is a legal firm. They use now robotics for capturing the any issue, any problem, or there where they want to take identify the judgments issued by the High Court, Supreme Court, or even maybe lower courts, they use robotics. Through robotics, they find out all the case laws on that particular topic. Now, this is something which you will have to do. Now, this investing in this kind of a technology needs capital. I do understand, but today you find that the courses on AI, ML are not so expensive. The foreign institutions provide that through the distant learning. Indian institutes are also now starting this whole thing through distant learning or maybe through classroom sessions. But this is what you will have to do to bring down your time to do the audits and do the audits more efficiently, and in fact in more effective way, where you can even capture the some irregularities happening in the company's management, or even some frauds taking place. If you really use these tools, it will be really helpful. And again, it doesn't really matter whether you are a small practicing chartered accountant or a big practicing chartered accountant. Yes, the big four firms have got the advantage, but you should really look at doing this more effectively and efficiently. The shareholder activism is going to be a very important problem. It was not there so far. I must tell you that if I have, and there are professional shareholders abroad who invest, and there is the shareholder activism which is very, very active in US, and to some extent also in Europe, where if they find that the managements are not doing anything, the shareholder value is not increasing, then they will go for not only change of management but change of auditors, and they may even file criminal cases against the management as well as the auditors. Now, what is very common abroad is likely to happen here also, because people are going to expect good returns on their investment, and from that point of view they are going to expect you as a watchdog to really ensure that their value is not destroyed. And therefore you need to be extremely careful when you do all these kind of work, whether statutory auditor, internal auditor, management auditor, or any consultancy that you provide. So this is true for practicing chartered accountant. This is also true for chartered accountants who are working in the company. I also expect, with the cost optimization which every company would be looking at, there will be consolidation of CA firms. You know, smaller firms, and I'm not saying every small firm should go and join big four firms, because they themselves have a problem. I recently read a case, and Sharat Yallurmam can perhaps throw light on it. I just read Supreme Court judgment last week pronounced that the lifting of the veil, which we had heard this whole lifting of the veil Solomon and Company case in the company law. That's the kind of a case we are now hearing, that Supreme Court is looking at the big four firms. There's a lifting of veil, because they have they used to audit and do the auditor under, say, KPMG, for example, Bharat Rao and Company, just to give actually the certificate of the accounts. So big four firms have their own issues, and I'm not saying anything against big four firms, so please don't misunderstand, because some of you are working for big four firms. But what I'm trying to say is the consolidation will happen amongst the smaller firms, and you need to therefore look at whether that consolidation, when it happens, whether it's the right way to do it or not do it. And so this is what I am going to talk about, rather this is where my part of opportunities and the challenges part comes to an end for practicing chartered accountants. I know that the existing work, like what you are doing of internal audit, statutory audit, tax assessments, so basically audit practice, tax practice will continue, but you have got tremendous opportunity now in terms of diversifying the scope of work in areas which I talked about. Some of you must be already doing it, but you need to look for more opportunities, and these opportunities will be available. So that's my second part of the and the last part of my presentation or talk, and I'm open to questions again on the second part.
Any questions from the other participants? Anybody has any questions?
Yeah, I'm Sandeep here. Sandeep Bhatt again. I think there are two things which I would, as a chartered accountant, do, and I'm already doing it in terms of investment and financial planning and wealth management. And that is something a chartered accountant, whether in practice or in terms of industry also, it should be looking at is from his point of view, whether if he's not in practice, if he's in practice, all the more. If he is in industry, he should look at that factor also in terms of his treasuries when he looks at his treasury income. That's number one. And number two is, in fact, and I just have completed a course from ICAI, and that is to do with alternate dispute resolutions, and this is for arbitration and you know, things of that sort. And the government is actually coming out with more efficient guidelines to see that our legal system, which is, you know, we have host of legal cases pending in the courts, how the legal system could be, you know, eased out. And chartered accountants is one area, you know, have been listed out in the new regulations, where chartered accountants above 10 years of practice can be enrolled as arbitrators. So this is one more area of practice which one could look at.
Yeah, I agree.
Any other questions? Hello? Any questions, Nati? I don't think there are any questions. But... Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Sunil ma?
I think Uday Gurkar ma'am and Sunil Burde ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. So Praveen ma'am, we've spoken on the corporate as well as on the practice. One thing on the individual front, as individuals in wealth management, is it the right time now to, should we exit mutual funds and get into FDs, or what is your guidance on that front?
Well, my personal, if you are asking me about my personal opinion, I do my own equity management, and I don't go for the to the mutual funds, because I personally believe that you should take care of your own money, or just rely on one good solid advisor, whether he comes from a mutual fund or some trusted kind of an investor, advisor. So that's what I would suggest. I mean, I'm going by my personal experience, so I should not force my view on others. But this is the right time to make investments, to be very frank. If you are a long-term investor, then this is the right time to make some investments.
Okay, thank you.
Praveen ma'am, what would you rate as the perspective on long term? Long term would mean 3 to 5 years?
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Okay. Anybody else? I don't think anybody has. Praveen ma'am, I don't think anybody has any questions.
I saw Uday Gurkar ma'am's. Unless Uday ma'am, you had any?
I think Praveen ma'am, you have covered so much. I think it is more than digestible now.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
I think you have covered very elaborate, and I think there is no area which I feel which is left out, because there are the traditional areas which we have been doing all these years, plus certain new areas which opportunities which we have already covered. So I don't have any questions on this.
Okay.
Sorry, with your permission, sir, can I ask Uday ma'am a question? Uday ma'am?
Yeah, tell me, Sandeep.
The thing is, in fact, people now are really worried on NPS, this NPS situation in banks. And since we are associated and so closely associated with SVC Bank, people, you know, in the know of banks have started asking questions as to what will happen of cooperative banks. Can you throw some light on that, please?
Yeah. You see, each bank has got its own liquidity issues. And as far as SVC Bank is concerned, I can talk about this bank, because since I've been associated with this bank. The fact is that as of today, we don't have any liquidity issue. And looking forward to the next 3 to 6 months, I don't think that we will have any liquidity issue, because during the year 2019-20, our growth in advances were absolutely negligible. But at the same time, in terms of deposits, we had big growth as such. But internal accruals at the same time, since RBI also came out with the, you know, reduction in our SLR, CRR, all these areas which we have been seeing in the last 2 months from December, January onwards. I think we won't have any liquidity issues. So now your question is on NPS. When you look at NPS, no doubt all of us are supposed to give a moratorium to the borrowers. So the current liquidity, if you see, we can take care of that. The only issue is that, yes, in the manufacturing will not take up that fast, as Praveen ma'am has already said, that even if our lockdown is kept up to 30th of April, but the real manufacturing will start only in the month of June. By the time they set up their things, at the same time, if I also say talk about certain industry-wise, if we see that, yes, in which industry you have your exposure, that's also an area which we need to look. So I think if I have to talk about SVC Bank, we may not have much of an issue on NPA. That's what I can tell you. This is how you manage your things, and you follow up as far as your recoveries are concerned, how you have continuous follow up with our borrowers. So I think it's manageable, because the follow up is very important in this, and I feel that we will not have that kind of an issue in the next 6 months to come. That's what I can tell you.
Yeah, thank you, Uday ma'am. It's a really sensitive issue, but just wanted to check out, because people, you know, since I'm from the community, people try to ask me this question, and I just have to be ready with an answer for that, and that's the reason why I checked it out.
Yeah, nice of you to, you know, giving this opportunity also to tell about the situation in our bank. Okay, Sandeep, thank you very much.
Hello. Praveen ma'am, Shailesh has a question. Shailesh.
Praveen ma'am, there is one question to you. What challenges or benefits an Indian CA firm, especially the firms which are run by our Bhanav CAs, usually as a sole proprietor, can have to form a network similar to a big four? What challenges or benefits you foresee
in creating a network?
Yeah, similar to a big four, like big four firms, how they run on a cooperative basis. Similar, what challenges you foresee in Indian setup like?
You know, the biggest challenge which you have is the lack of brand. The big four firms have the strong brand appeal, like you name, whether Deloitte, KPMG, PwC, or whichever firm it is, Ernst & Young, they all have got the big names. Right. So that itself is the first strong starting point, which many of you won't have it.
Right.
The second thing is they have the challenge of ready-made clients, because many parent companies which are using any of these big four firms in their parent country, when they come to start their operations in India, they would like to have the audits to be done, or tax practice, or whatever advice they need, they will go to their parent CA firm. So again, go back to one of the big four firms, even if they are starting the operation in India. So you don't have that ready client base. That's the second disadvantage. The third challenge, it's they have their very strong kind of a database of practices or case laws, whether it's a tax practice, then strong case laws, or how they had handled similar matter in company A, company B, which kind of a database they have, or how did they address some of the audit issues in their parent country or some other client's place. So that's the other advantage. The fourth challenge you have is the cost. They can afford to pay higher cost to their employees, which you are not in a position to pay. So that's the fourth disadvantage. And I can go on talking about other disadvantages also, because they use the technology which I mentioned. They use the technology like AI and ML and all that very effectively, which for you to make that investment, they of course made the investment. So it's not like they got it ready made. So they made, over the years, they made investment in this kind of a technology which they are using it today. And their cost of investment then gets spread across so many countries and so many clients. So naturally, their cost becomes manageable, of cost of investment becomes manageable, because they spread the cost across so many countries and so many clients. For you, it becomes difficult. So I would say that while these are the challenges, but what you should do is you should create your own network through your friends. If you were working in industry earlier, through your earlier company, and hopefully you left on the right side after, when you left with them, left from them, you kind of, so you have some kind of a track record, established track record with them, so they may give you some assignments. So start with that, and but it's a long haul. And people who have started the practice now in their early age will have a long haul ability, you know, long time which is available to them, as against, let's say, those who work for 20 years in industry and now starting the practice. Yes, they at least have a strong financial base, but would they get the strong client base will all depend upon your own earlier relationships, or by doing the networking yourself and trying to get the good clients. And if you do some good work for your one or two clients, even if they are small or medium, then the word spreads, and that's how you build a partner, how you build your firm. That's how you have to do it. But you have challenges.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Hello. Yeah.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
I'm Girish Chandavakar from Pune. Yeah, my I would like to have a question to Burkar ma'am, please. Hello, can I continue?
Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, basically for the last many months, this SME segment is going on with the recession and all that. And with this working capital, stringent working capital condition and the government directives to pay wages and the worker salaries and all that, can we expect from the banking some soft financing for this purpose? This can be taken as an opportunity also for the chartered accountants to generate finance for the SME segment.
Yeah, you know very well, Reserve Bank has already, you know, given these moratoriums for interest payment for the installment EMIs and all, if you remember that. Yeah. You see, when you talk about working capital requirements, so depending on, you know, each of the borrowers, the background, their the business growth in the last few years, one can only see that whether we can reduce their, you know, increase their drawing limits to a certain extent, and whether, you know, to a certain extent we can, whatever we have, what I should say, the security is what they give. So to what extent we can, you know, help them out, that is possible. But as far as the SVC stand is concerned, we will go each of the, you know, borrowers case to case basis, rather than, you know, giving any kind of a general, because you said that yes, whether we can ask whether borrowers we can see as a CA, we can suggest them. Yes, if your client is good, if he has a the background is good, so we may consider in such cases. So it's again based on case to case basis, rather than a general, you know, giving all kinds of such kind of support to them.
Yeah, with the reduction of CRR and all that, will the bank will be more this going for that?
Yeah, as I said, depending on each of the borrower which we have today.
Yeah, on the merit basis only.
Yeah, absolutely, on merit basis. What was his, you know, earlier, whether he has been paying in time, yes, no.
Will be no default support for that from the chair, this thing and all that, because many SMEs, many industries are already having a working capital crunch as it is.
Yeah, that's true.
Prior to the COVID condition, yeah.
So case to case basis and the relationship which we have over the earlier years, yes. These things are possible. This is how I would look at it.
Okay, thanks.
This is Sandeep here again, sorry. And this is in relation to what Pravit ma'am had said regarding leasing finance. You know, and he said there are only two companies actually doing leasing business. From what I understand, and I'm not an expert on income tax, but from what I understand, and the tax experts in the group can actually throw light. Is there any tax inefficiency in terms of leasing business? Can anyone who, you know, understands the leasing business better throw some light on it?
You mean the inefficiency for the lessor or for the lessee?
For the lessor.
I am not aware. Maybe Sharat ma'am is our tax expert. Or Kiran Mallapur ma'am or Sharat ma'am.
Yeah, because I've heard of it, and you know, and the big question is, why are there only two leasing companies in India? I mean, you know, it used to be a there used to be so many companies, leasing companies, and all of a sudden it's gone. So that's the question which I wanted answered, actually. So
there was the issue related to depreciation. I know claimability of depreciation as a tax deduction, but I don't know whether it is still an open issue or closed issue. I don't know as to who can claim the depreciation for. Am I right, Sharat ma'am or Kiran ma'am? You may be aware.
So So depreciation for finance leases, it was a litigated area.
Yeah.
So as things stand today, it's fairly clear that the lessor, that is the financier lessor, is the one who will be able to claim the depreciation.
Yeah. So, so Sharat Mam, to answer his question, Sandeep Mam's question, there are no tax issues now, or tax inefficiencies now from lessor's point of view.
Yes, I would think so.
Okay. Thank you.
You know, from the lessee's point of view, you are aware that I can claim the entire lease amount as deduction.
Yeah, that's true. That is efficient. So it was more the question of the lessor than the lessee.
Yeah. And frankly, I mentioned about all the companies, operating companies, manufacturing companies need to show free cash flow. And you know it very well, the importance of free cash flow, because you are in the same industry of investment banking and investment wealth, private equity, and so on and so forth. So free cash flow is very important. And that point of view, if operating lease becomes successful kind of a concept in India, then many companies will start showing good free cash flow.
Absolutely. And that's one of the things which I wanted, I'm propagating it. And somebody said that, this is there's an inefficiency from the tax angle. So I wanted that explanation.
Very fine.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Sorry, ek point actually on this leasing, GST into chikke difference em chapore tamil arena operating lease, the entire lease portion will be subject to a GST.
Correct.
Where in a finance lease, because it is normally split into a finance component and a lease component.
Yeah.
Typically, I think the finance component will not suffer a GST. That is what is my understanding. So the GST cost may be different.
But I can take the GST credit.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true. The GST credit is available, so that's not a big problem.
Yeah, only that it increases the working capital blockage, especially if the lessee, the user of the lessee is not able to liquidate the credit sooner. And in these conditions of businesses not being forecast, not being very sure, I think working capital will have a predominant role.
So, Sharat Mam, you're right. Each company will have to work out its own economics, whether it makes sense. From the point of view of GST amount blocked, and overall, if I can use the credit immediately, quickly, then fine, then it may be a good proposition.
Any other questions? I don't think there are questions on this topic.
I just wanted to thank all of you for giving a patient hearing to me. Somebody wants to talk.
Praveen ma'am, this is Amit Kalyanpur.
Amit.
Sorry, before we end this session, I just want to highlight one aspect. First of all, big thanks to Gautam Amaladi ma'am for having this network built. I think we can all depend on this network and use it for our own individual needs as well as for the benefit of the community. So one such benefit for the community is that I'm sure many of us are aware of that our MERT has a platform for the youngsters, which is called Chitrapur Yuvadhara. It is headed by Aditya Chandavarkar. It's called CYO for short. And from CYO, we had initiated a drive wherein we wanted to educate the younger group, which is the age group of 15 to 35. In the matters pertaining to personal finance. So we had one such session in August 2018 at Chirali for the Yuva Sammelan, and after that I think things didn't work out. So So we are trying to reinitiate this. So Sandeep Bhatmam has, he has taken the initiative to present or in the form of a webinar for personal finance. So he will educate youngsters with respect to, one is awareness with respect to personal finance, because not every youngster will be interested in the field of finance. So we've decided to split the presentation into two forms. One is basic and advanced. So we will, Praveenma, we will circulate the presentation, which will be agreed between Aditya, Sandeep Ma'am, and myself. We will circulate to you for your approval. But I want to just.
You mean today's presentation?
No, not today's presentation.
The presentation
which has been given by Sandeep Bhatmam.
Okay.
So I want to use this opportunity and ask the other CAs on this call that whether you can also initiate or get in touch with us at Chitrapur Yuvadhara, wherein in our respective sabhas or in our respective cities, we can initiate these sessions on awareness of personal finance. Because we are in an age where youngsters are earning a lot of money and it's very easy for us to spend money. So it's important that as a responsibility towards our community, we should guide our youngsters to channelize their savings properly and create awareness for this. So, Sandeep Bhatmam, if you want to add anything to this, please go ahead.
Nothing to add, in fact, and that's one of the things which, there was a question whether we should really sell out and invest in mutual, or sell out and put all our money into fixed deposits. There was a question, and my intent from that angle is to tell people my interest is to the general people, to educate them not only in terms of the investments or the stock markets or other things, but about investments and savings. So and I think Amit has rightly said, this initiative could go a long way in, introducing the savings culture in our society, in our community, as well as an investment culture. So that's the perspective which I was having.
Yeah, that's it, Praveen Ma'am. You can go ahead with.
Okay, so I just wanted to thank all of you to give a patient hearing to me, and I hope whatever I spoke was useful. And thanks a lot, Gautam Ma'am, to give me an opportunity. So
it's our pleasure.
Thank you.
Okay. Before
we want to thank you as well. Actually,
Sandeep, 1 minute. Before I go ask Uday Ma'am to propose a formal vote of thanks, there are two members who signed in late. So we just have their 1 minute introduction. One is Gurudat Manjeshwar. I can see you now, Gurudat Ma'am. You can put on your audio also and take 1 minute to introduce yourself. And after that, Krishna Balse also logged in late. Gurudat Ma'am. We can't hear you. Hello. Gurudat Ma'am. Krishna Ma'am, can you say something about yourself? Krishna Balse.
Yes, Gautam Ma'am. Hello.
Yeah.
Good morning to one and all. Extremely sorry I could join a little late because of we had some urgent office call in the morning. So my name is Krishna Jolse, and I am currently working with Konkan Railway Corporation Limited, a government undertaking company, as an assistant account officer, taxation. So I would say that this session, though I missed a couple of the initiating points, I would say it was extremely useful for an outlook of what lies ahead for the economy as well as for us new chartered accountants. And I would like to thank all of the presenters, especially Praveen Kadle Ma'am and Uday Gurkar Ma'am, for the valuable input. Over to you, Gautam Ma'am.
Yeah. Gurudat ma'am, you can take 1 minute. Yeah, Gurudat ma'am. Gurudat ma'am, I think we're not getting it. Gurudat ma'am, you well, mic. You can see you now. No, your volume. I got a sir. Tagala.
He just pinged that there's some problem with his audio.
Audio, I think so. You can post it on the chat otherwise. I think. Anyway, I'll ask Uday ma'am, please request Uday ma'am to propose a formal vote of.
Yeah, everybody can hear it now?
Yeah, Uday ma'am, you're audible.
First of all, thank you, Praveen ma'am, for a very, very nice, elaborate analysis of the economy. It's not only the Indian economy, you also covered what's happening worldwide, and it's really very informative. And you shared quite a lot of data, which I also noted down. I think as a banker also, it's very much useful to me. Your suggestion to some of these, what the government should do, I think they are also very much valid. I'm quite sure that some communication should go to them. It will help the whole Indian economy as such. Your advice on investment, whether we should do it in property, what's going to be the, you know, happen in the next few years, few days, few months, what is going to be the investment opportunity, what is going to happen in the property related things. That's also very much useful. And in the banking sector, he said, yes, we should liberalize. I fully agree with you, because today we are working with a lot of restrictions, a lot of, circulars coming from the Reserve Bank have been quite tough for these banks, because we have to service our customers, our deposit holders, at the same time also help our borrowers to grow in their business. So it's really a big challenge for us. And also you spoke about how China has created the infrastructure, so that how fast they have gone beyond, they are almost now number two, which probably in a very soon they are going to be number one as compared to the US. So it's a very insightful information and the analysis which you have given. Thank you very much for that. This is as far as the economy is concerned. And when we talk about opportunities for CA, I think it's absolutely relevant, you know, that how we can help SME industries today by way of, you know, the management audits, by way of our operations audit, how they can be benefited, how they can reduce their costs. I think you spoke about even IT costs and other costs. Yes, capital expenditure has been increasing. Even within our bank also, it has been the same. A lot of opportunity, like maybe cloud-based services one takes, how that will be more beneficial than, you know, investing in hardware, software, maintenance. It's a huge cost for anybody. I can understand that. It's a very good insight for me also. Related to other areas of cost, like power costs and other things which have covered very nicely. Free cash flow management and business continuity assurance. They're all really risk identification for the management and helping them in, you know, identifying those risks and how to mitigate those risks. These are all certain areas. And you rightly said that forex management is one area which most of the chartered accountant has not been doing. It's one of the real good area. If one can study a little bit in that and, you know, advise the management on that, that's going to be a good thing for the management also. Then working capital management, I think we have covered almost everything. That's why I said that there is nothing which is left out, which is not being covered. I'm quite sure that this has benefited each one of us who have attended this particular, I think around 29, 30 people have attended this particular video conference. It's been very nice of you to share your views and put it so intelligently. I really admire you. Thank you very much for that.
Second, Umam, just sorry.
Yeah, sure.
No, just intervention, since you mentioned about China GDP, yes, India GDP. I just wanted to give one statistics. I should have given it earlier. As I mentioned, 1979 Chinese economy, they started liberalizing, and we started in 91. From 79 to 2020, in 41 years, the Chinese economy is now close to $15 trillion. Our economy is now $3 trillion. So we were at the same level, more or less. Maybe slightly China, because of the size of population, they were slightly above us. But after 41 years, we are still 1/4 of what they are. In fact, more, less than 1/4. They are 15 trillion. We are 3 trillion. 14 and a half what they are, and we are 3 trillion.
Absolutely.
So the gap is still very wide. Sorry. Sorry, go ahead.
A lot of political instability we have gone through all these years. Yeah, what I was trying to say is that India had a lot of political instability. You know, people at that particular level where if had they taken up, probably things would have been different. Anyhow, it's the past now. That's okay. But really, I thank you very much for covering in such a analytical way. I think each one of us have got the benefit of this. Secondly, I thank each one of you for, you know, as Praveen Ma'am also said, being very patient, but it's really interesting. So that we were so much engrossed, we didn't even know that we spent almost 1.5 hours, more than that, rather. I think it's really interesting. So it helped us a lot. From each one of the participants, I thank you very much. And also certain questions which have been raised by Sandeep Ma'am, Sachin Ma'am, Rohan Ma'am, and some others. I think it's quite gave so many clarifications for those which probably people wanted to have. And last but not the least, Gautam, this is a real wonderful idea of all the CAs coming together. So though we are all staying at home, but we are all together today. It's such an opportunity for us to, you know, listen and hear some of the profiles which people have expressed during the conversation. I think it's very nice to have arranged this kind of a conference. Let's keep doing it more often, so that anybody's expertise, who has certain expertise in certain areas, even maybe a half an hour or maybe a 45 minutes, if they speak and, you know, get the, we can all share their knowledge. It will be useful for the whole the Bhanup CA group as such. And thank you very much for all these arrangements.
Thank you.
Yeah.